praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. You guys say amen.
Amen.
Verse 3, and not only so, but we glory in tribulation also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patient experience, and experience hope. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
I want to talk this morning on this subject, living through adversity. Living through adversities. Amen? Living through adversity. The word adversity, words that are synonyms of adversity is difficulties, misfortunes, trouble, hardship, disease, disaster, suffering, affliction, even sorrow and misery, tribulation, woe, and pain are synonyms of the word adversity. Adversity says that it's a condition marked by misfortune, calamity, and distress. We want to take you through adversity, but we as Christian folk, it says in the Bible what happens to us when we go through adversity. The Apostle Paul had said something else. He talked about faith and grace, but he said there is something else that we got that nobody else got. He said we can glory in tribulation, which means we can glory in adversities. And he tells us why. He said, because when you go through adversities, it works out patience. And when you got patience, you got experience. And when you have experience, the last thing you got is hope. So through adversity, brings about hope. First thing we need to know that Jesus did not promise us that the Christian life would be easy. Adversity develops character. And that's how we can make it through hard times. All of us, no matter who you are, will face adversities. The question is not whether we will face trials and tribulation, but it is, the question is, how will you respond to the bad things that happen in your life? That is what counts. How you respond to difficulties. Will you allow difficulties and discouraging experience of life make you bitter or makes you better? Makes you bitter or makes you better? Romans 8:28 says, for all things work together for the good of those that love the Lord. It says that will our reaction to this bad experience work for the good and bring us closer to Jesus Christ, or will it draw us into despair and causes us to seek some ungodly solution? We may not be able to understand why bad things happen to us, but we can grow to an understanding that it is adversity and it is not the smooth road that makes us better. Amen? We got many books was written, many inspirational books was written to help us get through adversity. But the greatest stories of people that went through adversities is found in the Bible. In fact, the Bible is one continuous story about the difficult ways, in the different ways individuals handle their adversities. The Bible tells us that every last one of them went through some stuff. And the Bible tells us those stories so we can know that these people went through adversities. Different people. Amen, somebody? You know, think about Hannah, what she went through before she had a child. Amen. One thing I learned, I liked about her, I was reading her story the other day, is that she prayed. She labored in prayer because she could not have a child. And when the man of God told her, go about your way, by this time next year you will have a child. And remember what God did for you. And I like what she did, since when, once she had that child, she brought that child back to God. Amen? And gave him to God. And he became one of the greatest preachers God ever had in the Bible. She gave him back. She went through adversity and had the audacity to come and to sacrifice to the Lord, to give her child to the Lord. How you handle adversity? We need to understand the fundamental concept about how God uses hard ways and hard times to develop characters within us. It is our character, our true character in Jesus Christ, that will determine how we will handle adversities. First, we must realize that God is still in control. Somebody gonna help me here? Not only is he still in control, but God loves us more than anything else in the world. But this basic fact must be our foundation, must be the foundation of our thinking that God is in control and that God loves us. Whenever you go through something, remember this, God is still in control. And God loves me. God says, say to yourself, I know God loves me. And I know you're still in control. We must realize, secondly, that this life on earth is training ground, where God builds our character so that when we get to heaven, we can praise God like we never praised him before. We spend a few years on this earth, but we're going to spend millions times millions in heaven. Amen, somebody? Hopefully our character will continue to improve throughout eternity. We don't have to know how all of this works. What we do know is that we have only a short time on this earth. But for as we go through testing time, God wants to use our experience, good or bad, to draw us closer to him. Can I say that again, y'all? He wants to use our experience, whether it's good or bad, to draw us closer to him. That does not sound right. That is exactly how God works. Also, we must not measure the goodness of our life by the ease of the good times or the difficult times. When you read the Beatitudes, you're going to learn how the adversity that God, how God blesses you through adversity. Bless the Lord, lose that moment. Right. Hallelujah, somebody. Read the Beatitudes. He started off telling you, I'm going to bless you no matter who you are. Bless the Lord, the poor. And then he adds to the back part. He blesses each one of you. He blesses you. He's telling you when you are going through something, you're already blessed. Read the Beatitudes, y'all. Read the Beatitudes. He started off saying, blessed is. Then he tells what the blessed is. He started off saying, blessed are you. Then he tell you what you're going through. And then he tell you what he'll do for you. Now that's some shouting stuff, y'all. Yeah. All right, y'all? Read the Beatitude demonstrates God's great love and his rich blessing to those who humbly undergo hardship. To suffer for God is an honor and a privilege, and it brings about spiritual reward that we cannot measure. Amen? Adversity brings about a reward that we cannot measure. Certainly, we must avoid suffering, but God will use our suffering for his glory and for his honor. Amen. We must have faith that God knows what he's doing. We must understand God knows what he's doing. We must believe that God really knows what he's doing. And that all things will work for our good, for us, because we love the Lord. If you love the Lord, whatever you go through, God is working in your life. Because you do know he already had a plan for you. When you look back over your life and seeing what you've been through, God was training you, God was building you, God was preparing you, and he's still doing it. Amen, somebody? prefers an easy life. I don't know about y'all, but I want an easy life. I don't like no pain. I heard it takes a pill. Amen, somebody. Hallelujah. So, well, sometimes you just got to go without a pill and lean and depend on the goodness of God. Somebody help me here. And I know we take a pain because we feel, take a pill because we feel like we die. I don't know about y'all. Sometimes I hurt so bad and get so sick, I think I'm dying. And what happens when I think I'm dying? I go to pray. How deep do I pray? I really pray, y'all. I get intense in my prayer. I get crazy in my prayer. I get hard in my prayer. I look to the goodness of God. Lord, I start calling God. I start calling God and say, Lord, there's some things, some stuff I did for him. Somebody help me here. Then I start calling and say some things I did for people. Somebody help me here. And I start justifying all that I ever did. Lord, you got to help me. I get intense. Something I already bless you. And how you gonna tell me something I already know? Not only do I know, Lord, I'm about to shout right here. Not only do I know what you did, I know what you're doing. And I know what you will do. Somebody help me here? Because I know everything. Amen, somebody? I'm in control of everything. But I prefer the flesh in me, prefer the easy life. But God's ways is not our ways. One thing is for certain, we will not be able to figure out all the answers. We may not understand why we have a hard time, but those times will come. Just know God will use adversity for your good according to his purpose, not according to our purpose, if we love him. God's ways is not man's ways. Bad things do happen to so-called good people. You ask the question, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, why do good things happen to bad people? If you can answer the second one, you ought to be able to answer the first one. Somebody help me up in this place. Amen? When we can prove that bad things has happened to a good person, we make a judgment of who is good and who is bad. Who are you? To determine who's good and who's bad. Amen, somebody? God's standards and the world's standard is different. What you think is good is not good to the Lord. What you think is bad is not bad to him. Amen, somebody? I simply would put it this way. 1,000 years is as one day to the Lord, and one day is as 1,000 years. His ways is not like our ways, because his ways is higher than our ways. Lost Street, we live in the standards of God this year. Can I be messing with us up in here? Because we are reaching for the standards of God, the enemy have come in our church. Y'all can catch that? Hallelujah, somebody. And he has removed people in our life who we love so dearly because we are reaching for higher standards. The more you love God, the more you'll make the enemy mad. Y'all didn't catch that. Jesus says in this world you will have trials and tribulations, but he had be of good cheer. Because I have already overcome the world. Hallelujah, somebody. So Jesus has said, reach for the highest standard. But while you're reaching, trouble will come into your life. But he says, be of good cheer, because I'm right there with you. Amen, somebody? Amen. Ain't nothing you gonna go through that Jesus already been through. Amen. As a matter of fact, nothing you gonna go through that Jesus has been through worse than what you're going through. Amen. I'm not going to end. Amen, somebody? Amen. In Jesus' day, everyone assumed that the Pharisees were good people.
Right.
They were the religious people. They were the good people. But on the other hand, the world would have said that the prodigal son and Mary Magdalene were bad people. But Jesus talked good about Mary Magdalene. Jesus talked good about the prodigal son. Ain't God all right? The religious people, they look good. They dress good. They talk good. They walk good. But they and pretty on the outside, but on the inside it's filled with dead men, dead bones. Somebody help me here. Mary Magdalene was possessed with seven devils. The prodigal son left his father's house and spent all his money partying. But watch what happened when the Lord touched him. Hallelujah, somebody. Can I use him for an example? He had good things in his life. But when the good things ran out, he got caught in adversities. And it was then and then only that he said, I must pick myself up and go back to my father's house. Amen, somebody? Mary Magdalene ran into Jesus. And when she got into Jesus, cast out seven devils. Lord have mercy, what's that? Can't deal with one death. How did she deal with seven deaths? Was she not messed up, y'all? And then there was one even more messed up than her. Because Jesus called him and told the demons within him, what is your name? He said, my name is Legion. Because we are men. Lord have mercy. I just fell to my knees and got weak when I heard him say that. And watch this. They said, oh, then Jesus says, I can get rid of you. But they said, Lord, if you please, send us into the hogs. And to let you know just possibly how many they had, there was 2,000 hogs that were filled with demons. So how many demons could he possibly could have had in him? He was in a messed up state. Ain't God all right? Sometimes when I see people that's insane and talking to themselves and acting up, I say, Lord, have mercy, in the name of Jesus, rebuke that demon that's in them. Sometimes when I see people get so angry, somebody, y'all don't want to talk to me, huh? They get so angry. Hallelujah, somebody. And I just want to stretch my hand and say in the name of Jesus, get out of here. But I say it real low, y'all. Sometimes I say it to myself, but then that ain't I don't want to get hurt. Amen. Some of y'all catch all of that. But I say it to myself, Jesus. Hallelujah, somebody. Because when you got a angry spirit, a wild spirit, that spirit is out of control. That's not of God, that's the spirit of the devil. God is a spirit of calmness. A spirit of peace. Read your Bible. What the gift of the spirit is. Amen. When you feel yourself getting out of control, say in the name of Jesus, that's not who God called me to be. Yourself under control. Hallelujah, somebody. If you read the sermon in Matthew 23, you will see the deadly sins of pride, arrogance, and a lack of love that permeated with the Pharisees' lives. Now compare Jesus' opinion of the Pharisees. Compare Jesus' opinion of the Pharisees with Jesus' eyes. So when we talk about good people, we must be careful in making a judgment. Jesus said there is none that is good. Right. When Jesus said that, he was referring to us in our natural state, in our fleshly state, apart from the work of the Holy Ghost within us. Therefore, since a man is good, we should always avoid judging others or thinking God is being unjust to good people. Watch yourself with that. The truth is that the concept of bad people and good people doesn't exist in the way we think it does. Right. The truth is that we are all sinners and come short of the glory of God. That's you and you and you and you and you and you and me. Right. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Yeah. But you know what gets to me when people sin and say, well, we all sin. Amen, somebody. You ain't no better than me. And I ain't no better than you. Yeah, that's fine. But that don't give you an excuse to sin. Hallelujah, somebody. God will forgive us of all of our sin. But the Apostle Paul said, God forbid that God just lets you keep on sinning. Stop by and tell him, he ain't gonna let you just keep on sinning. Hallelujah, somebody. Some people think he's gonna stop you right then and there and keep you from sinning. Sin, and to you that sin will not look wrong. And it'll be wrong as two letters. Father, help me up in here. Hallelujah. Be careful that you already know it's wrong. Give it up. And if you don't have the power to give it up, ask God to help you to give it up.
Because you know if you get out the house, you will get in some trouble. You will start
to mess somewhere. Ain't that all right? And sometimes you gotta keep you in your own house to keep.